name is Salman Hamid, and I'm Assistant Professor of Integrated Science and Humanities at Hampshire College.
I'm Kevin Anderson. I teach courses in film and anthropology at the University of Massachusetts, and this is Film Autopsy.
There will be people on the outside who will not understand the condition you men have. Now, upon your shoulders rests the responsibility of a post-war world.
And smile.
You can start a business, filling station, grocery, or hardware store. Get a few acres of land and raise some chickens.
You have a break coming?
10 minutes.
If the average civilian had been through the same stresses that you have been through, undoubtedly, they too would have developed the same nervous condition.
You must understand.
Hello, welcome to the Film Autopsy of the Master. It's a new film directed, written, and produced by Paul Thomas Anderson, starring Philip Seymour Hoffman, Joaquin Phoenix, Amy Adams, and Laura Dern. It is a very compelling film taking place right after World War II about a vet from the war, played by Joaquin Phoenix, who's kind of a wandering soul and holds down various jobs, but not for very long, trying to maybe find his way. And at one point, he comes across, in almost this kind of dreamlike sequence, this boat at night lit up very beautifully. He becomes a stowaway on the boat and quickly crosses paths with Philip Seymour Hoffman. Their fondness for hooch and their tendency to invent their own versions of reality seems to bind them. They're almost like two sides of the same coin. How did you take this?
I mean, it's first of all, I mean, you did a fantastic job of it, at least putting it in context, because this is a really hard film to describe, and this is one of those films that I don't think we can actually spoil the movie, because it's very hard to describe the flow of the film. So I absolutely loved the film, but here is how I would put it: I don't exactly know why I loved the film. if you say, okay, well, what was it? Like, you know, I won't be able to say. To me, one thing that I found after watching the film, you know, was not a theme that attracted me to the film, but rather I had almost an experience of watching it. And I felt I loved the film. Well, but that was an interesting aspect. Yeah. Like, you know, I felt I loved the film, but if you were to ask me, why did I feel that way? Mm-hmm. I think I would have a hard time describing it. And so it's really, and that's one of the things that I actually really talk about in the film also, that you need to experience things. And so I thought that was phenomenal.
Yeah, that's such an interesting, I really love the way you put that, because the experience, the cinema going experience of watching this film is so much akin to what at least one of the themes is in the film. To talk a little bit here, it's not a biopic about L. Ron Hubbard, and it's not a film about Scientology, but that figure and that belief system certainly inform the story that Paul Thomas Anderson is telling. Philip Seymour Hoffman is a rather wealthy individual. He's a theoretical philosopher, a physician, a barista as well, I guess. I don't know. But when the two of them cross paths, and Joaquin Phoenix's performance is just riveting, and I think that's at least one thing we can say that really captures us, is the scenes between those two. And there's so many scenes with just the two of them, it really kind of takes you away, and they embody their characters so well. It's a really amazing performance on both parts. I think we're going to see some nominations.
Well,
I mean,
usually when Philip Seymour Hoffman is on the screen, he engulfs the whole screen. He chews up the scenery.
Yeah.
And I was like completely taken aback by seeing, like, you know, that when him and Joaquin Phoenix are on the screen, and they are a lot, especially the first processing scene when he processes Joaquin Phoenix's character. I mean, that is such a riveting scene. Mm. And Joaquin Phoenix, I think, steals the scenery from Philip Seymour Hoffman, and you don't say that often.
Yeah.
And so I agree. I mean, this, just seeing those two together, mm-hmm. I mean, that by in itself, you know, I mean, sometimes you go like, okay, well, you know, I would love to see a movie with just them sitting together having dinner or whatever. Well, this is the kind of film where you let these two great actors just do what they are doing. And I think that's what creates this this experience. And I'm glad that you clarified this, that even though there have been rumors running around that it's a Scientology film, it's based on L. Ron Hubbard, well, certainly there is an inspiration and the time frame is the same.
Yeah.
But I think that's all there is. And I think it goes beyond that. But one of the things that are, so if you were to say, and I did think about what is the movie about, I mean, to me, it looked like, there are so many different ways of thinking about it. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautifully shot film with a lot of scenes of water. And I was just wondering if you thought, it was kind of like, just you cannot make an image out of a water. You cannot make a picture of what the water is giving you. To me, it seemed sort of like when we are saying that, well, we cannot make sense of the movie. Maybe it is something like water.
Right, and not just water like in a glass as like a motif. Oh, no. It's more of a recurring shot kind of from the
back of the boat.
From the back of a boat looking down at the moving through the water, and the water's being churned at the same time. So I think there is this, it certainly works as a kind of a metaphor for fluidity and almost the impossibility to grasp and hold on to something like
that. Or a Rorschach test for whatever you want to see in the film, right? I mean, there are multiple ways of looking at that. Yeah.
Perhaps we can go down one road. You mentioned that the time frame is kind of similar to L. Ron Hubbard and Scientology. I think what I found one of the interesting things was this kind of mid-20th century, right after the great victory of World War II, Philip Seymour Hoffman's character is launching, there's like a new frontier, you know, and it's the frontier within. It's about perfecting the human, and that seems to be his main purpose. You know, he has this belief system that our souls have been around for trillions of years and whatnot, but it's about fighting this inner battle. And I think that juxtaposition between the ending of World War II and then beginning this inner journey, I found rather, rather interesting and not just coincidental.
Well, but that's also the time when you have Jungian, ideas coming along, post-Freud in that sense, but you also have a number of these kind of movements around the 50s that really took over. And here there is, at one point, there is this, a skeptic also shows up, and that's a riveting scene as well, mm-hmm. who challenges the master, right? So I think that particular time is also ripe where these experimentations are going on, mm-hmm. and that's why L. Ron Hubbard and a lot of UFO religions and things like that mm-hmm. are coming around that time. But even just the master, if I can point one other thing, because to me it looked like, and you know, that perhaps you can see this movie, and again, there are so many ways, as a love story between Joaquin Phoenix and Philip Seymour Hoffman. Mm-hmm. But why? And there were these couple of times when Philip Seymour Hoffman character says, like, you know, well, you are kind of like, and he was referring to Joaquin Phoenix, like, you know, you're kind of like latitudes with no lands. Like, you know, and you are one person with them, like, you know, no master, mm-hmm. like, you know, and that's what he was. Perhaps that was the attraction mm-hmm. of Philip Seymour Hoffman to Joaquin Phoenix, because even though Philip Seymour Hoffman's character was always in charge, he was the master.
Yeah, very grounded.
One person who he could never master was Joaquin Phoenix. But Joaquin Phoenix did not leave, but he made sure to tell him that I'm not leaving because of my will, not because I'm under your control. I thought that balance mm-hmm. was just really fascinating.
Well, it's such a signature performances by these two actors. I think Paul Thomas Anderson, with his previous film, There Will Be Blood, I mean, he's really starting to impress me as a filmmaker. I wasn't so crazy about some of his earlier stuff. It was well done, a little goofballish, you know, Boogie Nights and Punch Drunk Love. I know some people liked. Couldn't stand
that. Was good, yeah.
But he is, I mean, now that he's not just directing and writing, but he's also producing his own stuff, I don't want to use the K word, but yeah. I think we got some Kubrick going on.
We have to be careful about that, but certainly, it is dark. Thematically, it's dark, and the imagery is spectacular. I mean, the shots, I would say that if you have a chance to see this on the big screen, see that, because the expansive shots are spectacular, and the expressions on the actors, that's also spectacular. So I think it's one of the best movies I've seen this year, and you will be talking about it after the films. Most of them are non-actors, so go see it. It's fantastic.
And Academy Award nominations for Quvenzhané Wallace and I think adapted screenplay.
And I think a lot of material to this. I surrender all my love to you.